Next on Enviro Close Up, Commander Robert Greene and security without nuclear deterrence. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Carl Grossman with Commander Robert Greene. Thanks for being with us, Commander Greene.
Thank you, Carl. It's wonderful that you have given me this opportunity to catch up with where the world is and with nuclear weapons.
Now, you served for 20 years in the British Navy, and you were deeply involved in its readiness to use nuclear weapons. As a bombardier-navigator, you flew in Buccaneer nuclear strike jets with a planned target, the Soviet Union, and then helicopters armed with nuclear depth charges to be used against Soviet submarines. Then you worked at the Ministry of Defense, and you were staff officer for intelligence to the Commander-in-Chief Fleet during the 1982 Falklands War. You retired from the Navy in 1982 and became an opponent of nuclear warfare. You chaired the UK affiliate of the World Court Project, a citizens' campaign which led the International Court of Justice in 1996 to rule that the threat and the use of nuclear weapons were illegal. You're the author of several books, including Security Without Nuclear Deterrence, and you're the co-director of the Disarmament and Security Center in New Zealand. Let's start off, Commander Greene, by talking about nuclear deterrence. What is nuclear deterrence exactly?
It's the threat to use nuclear weapons in order to basically oppose any aggression against you when the conventional exchange looks like is going to go against you. And so you resort to nuclear weapons in the hope that your aggressor will climb down. But there are huge problems, of course, if your aggressor also has nuclear weapons. So you have a game of chicken, basically, that you're confronting.
You're right in Security Without Nuclear Deterrence of, after leaving the Navy, hearing of a very secret contingency plan to move a Polaris submarine within range of Buenos Aires in Argentina, and the possibility of conducting a nuclear strike on Argentina. You write how, for you, the Falklands War raised major concerns relating to nuclear weapons.
Fortunately, there was no need for that plan to be implemented because we won. But at one point, Mrs. Thatcher was determined to take on Argentina over the Falklands, over the Argentinian invasion of the Falklands in 1982, because they had a historical claim to them. In fact, they are known not as the Falkland Islands in Argentina, but as Las Malvinas. And it was a time when Britain was basically offloading its colonial territories, and we were down to just a few islands dotted around the world and Hong Kong. And so that was basically the situation. And the problem, of course, for Britain and Mrs. Thatcher was that General Galtieri, who was the leader of the junta in Argentina at the time, decided to call Mrs. Thatcher's bluff, that she would never escalate to use of nuclear weapons over these islands with a few million sheep and about 1,000 British citizens down in the near Antarctica. And of course, it was an absolutely bizarre war for the Royal Navy, because we basically never expected to go to war over it. And it was the most difficult place to get to. Apart from anything else, getting the army there was a huge problem in terms of trying to get troopships down there. Unfortunately, we had nuclear submarines, which could get in ahead of the main task force and could patrol around the islands. But of course, it was a preempted attack, and so we had to dislodge them. And it was a very close-run thing.
Now, in chapter one of your book, Security Without Nuclear Deterrence, it's entitled the chapter, Why I Rejected Nuclear Deterrence. You write how there's been a systematic effort to play down the appalling side effects and overkill with even the smallest modern nuclear weapons. You go on about how nuclear weapons aren't weapons at all. There are utterly indiscriminate devices that combine the poisoning horrors of chemical and biological weapons of mass destruction, plus effects of radioactivity, with almost unimaginable explosive violence.
If I may, I would like to take the opportunity to bring in a scenario which is right up to date, and that is to do with Vladimir Putin's threat on invading Ukraine, that if NATO, led by the United States and UK, tried to stop him, then he would invoke use of nuclear weapons. And of course, as far as I'm concerned, that is a completely empty threat, and I'm happy to explain why.
Please do.
If you are trying to use nuclear weapons in what we call a regional context, which is where this is a territory that is bordering the southern flank of Russia. And it actually is, it includes Crimea and the very important Russian naval base in Sevastopol. And basically, it is the only warm water outlet for Russia. All the others tend to be around the north in the Arctic and up in near Vladivostok, where they freeze over in winter. And this is not the case in the Crimea. And so this was, if you like, a red line issue for Putin. And my take on this is that you need to understand that Putin is not just a politician. He is a highly trained intelligence officer who was trained by the KGB. And he's fluent in German. So this guy is a serious operator. And he also understands nuclear deterrence doctrine in some depth. And it is my view, which is considered rather subversive, that basically he was using the blind acceptance of nuclear deterrence dogma by both the NATO nuclear forces and Russia to take advantage of that in order to make the US and UK back off. And so far, thank God, it's worked. But of course, if you actually did pursue this and invoke this threat, then it would be a disastrous own goal for Putin, because nuclear weapons cannot be used militarily. They are so indiscriminate. But worse than that, Ukraine is one of the breadbaskets of the world, and particularly for Russia. It's prime agricultural land, and any attempt to use a nuclear weapon there would be just cause a radiation catastrophe, a health disaster, and would, of course, cause escalation by the United States into nuclear World War III. So the whole thing is absolute nonsense.
Now, in a section, Nuclear Deterrence and the Absence of War Between the Major Powers, you write, what does one make of the pro-nuclear lobby's assertion that nuclear weapons have prevented war between the major powers. And I think this is the main argument that, I mean, in terms of deterrence, we having nuclear weapons, the Soviets, now Russia having nuclear weapons, China having nuclear weapons, the French have, and so forth. With so many countries now have nuclear weapons, there's not been, so far, a major war with nuclear weapons.
My answer to that is, thanks to, by the grace of God, that it hasn't, because the great danger of the nuclear element is that it is open to miscalculation, and particularly to do with intelligence. And the real danger, and this is my area of expertise and experience, the danger of getting false intelligence. And we know that there have been at least 13 instances since the Cold War ended in 1991, 92, where there were false alarms. And in one particular case, in 1995, there was a weather rocket was launched off the northern coast of Norway, and it was misinterpreted by the Russian intelligence apparatus. And it caused, I think it was Yeltsin, President Yeltsin at the time, to go to full alert to release a nuclear weapon response before the missiles landed. Because the problem is, there is this issue of you have to use it or lose it. And this is this ghastly business where we are still on hair trigger alert with the need to perhaps launch before the arrival of strategic missiles so that the actual missiles themselves are not destroyed in the first strike.
Going back to your involvement as a naval officer in the Royal Navy in nuclear activity, you write in the book how the area that the particular bomber that you were on, its mission in a nuclear war was to hit an area, well, near what's now St. Petersburg. And actually, you talk about going to St. Petersburg years later. And well, can you relate what you told the folks in St. Petersburg?
Yes. It was extraordinary that I always remember my pilot and I were chosen to be one of the four top crews in our squadron at the time. And only four crews out of the 14 were selected for the nuclear mission. And this was considered a great honor. And we had to get a special top security clearance in order to be briefed about the target. And I always remember we were in the aircraft carrier and we were taken down into a small compartment in the bottom of the ship, which I'd never been to before, didn't know existed. And inside this was the nuclear planning room. And basically we were then told, congratulations, you have been selected to be a nuclear crew. And you know that this is basically the last ditch defense of our country's way of life, history, traditions. And our little chests swelled with pride. And then they said, right, we're going to give you the target and we're not going to let you out of here until you have planned how to attack it. And then we'll you give back the maps and leave here and you don't talk about it. And of course, I was the navigator. And the first question I asked was, well, where are we going to take off from? Because we were in an aircraft carrier. And I had a terrible feeling that they had not been asked that question before. Because all they said was, we're somewhere halfway up the Norwegian Sea. And anyway, we went ahead and planned it. But what we discovered was that in order to attack, it was a military airbase on the outskirts of Leningrad at the time, which is now St. Petersburg. We had to fly, obviously, across Norway. We couldn't go around Sweden because we hadn't got enough fuel. We had to go straight over Sweden. And Sweden, of course, is a neutral country. It doesn't belong to NATO, although it's trying to join now, which I suggest is a bit of a sad, plan. But anyway, and so basically, my pilot and I just had a huddle in which we said, what do we do about this? And we did actually ask the question. And they said, oh, don't worry about that. You know, this is going to be World War III. And so we went ahead, planned it, and we realized still that we wouldn't get back to the ship. We hadn't got enough fuel. And so we actually had to plan to eject, hopefully over Sweden, in fact, because we couldn't even get back to Norway and hope that the locals would take pity on us. So that was my inauguration into being a nuclear crew.
Another, well, you tell this story about when your mission changed to use nuclear depth, what were they called, depth bombs or?
Yep, depth bombs.
Depth bombs on Soviet submarines. I mean, the bombs were like the power of the Hiroshima bomb. And you were being a helicopter. This is when you were assigned to a helicopter. And I mean, the explosion would just disintegrate, would blow up not just maybe the submarine down below, but the helicopter you're on.
Correct. The one advantage we had in the Buccaneer nuclear strike jet was that at least we came in low level, high speed. We then pulled up about 5 miles to the target and executed the actual release of the bomb in the climb. And it went on, it's called a long toss maneuver. And so you could then turn away immediately, you'd released it and pull down to sea level and escape from defenses. But now with a helicopter, you don't have that option. You can only do 100 knots and you're on the you're above the surface of the ocean. And one of the things that I realized when I shifted into helicopters was that basically there was a real danger that I would actually be brought down by the base surge from my own detonation of my own weapon. So this was a suicide mission. And then there was the radioactivity, and I did complain about that. And they said, oh, don't worry. We'll only use it ever in deep water. So hundreds of miles away from coastline where there's civil population, and probably the Soviets would not even notice it. And I thought, huh, I'm not very convinced with this. But of course, they then used the final Trump argument, which was, and of course, Rob, remember, you've got a very good career ahead of you, so just don't rock the boat. And so I said, okay, and I just hope we never have to use it.
Well, you sure have been rocking the boat in terms of nuclear weaponry in a bunch of decades since 1982. And you write in the book, and you stress this in the book, that there are alternative non-nuclear strategies to deter war and secure a just and lasting peace. And you elaborate on that in the book. Can you elaborate on that now, please?
I go back to the Ukraine scenario where, you know, nuclear weapons have no role in that war. And, you know, there's dreadful attrition going on, endless military aid, of course, to a small, you know, country that's on the periphery of Russia. This talk about defeating Putin and Russia, I mean, it's rather like trying to make the argument that Mexico could actually be supported by China in beating the United States when push comes to shove. And of course, it's an absolute nonsense. And I'm sure that if Putin was even overthrown or assassinated, then there would be a long queue of successors who would follow his policy on this one, because the whole situation of Ukraine is a red line issue for Russia historically. And so, no, I just feel that the only way to resolve this militarily is by conventional forces if need be, but ultimately we all know there's going to have to be a ceasefire, there's going to have to be negotiations, and probably Ukraine is going to have to be guaranteed neutrality in order to have any chance of peace and stability there. And it'll probably have to be guaranteed by United Nations forces, but you can see at the moment that it's going to go on into the current stalemate that it is.
Now, you write about the treaty on the prohibition of nuclear weapons, and that was passed at the General Assembly of the United Nations in 2017, like the World Court determination. It would ban the stockpiling, the use, the threat, and so forth of nuclear weapons. But the nuclear weapons states, including the United Kingdom and the United States and France and so forth, they won't sign on. There's 122 nations initially that signed on, and there's been more since, most of the world, but not the nuclear states. What does one do about that?
Well, yes, I was there, and it was a very exciting time. And it was spearheaded by a group called the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons. And we were there in support, and it went through. And the only reason it went through was because, of course, none of the nuclear states had delegations there. They boycotted it. And then, of course, they tried to rubbish it afterwards. But they're in a small minority, and they're wrong. But the problem is that realpolitik demands that somehow you try to continue negotiating with the nuclear weapon states to encourage them to join one day. And so there were clauses in that treaty which were weak. And one of them was that a nuclear power didn't have to get rid of its nuclear weapons before joining the treaty. Things like this. And there was a let-out clause, I think it's Article 17, which states that any state can leave if its national security is at stake. I mean, that's completely contradicting the whole emphasis of it. And the only reason that such a big majority was achieved was because those compromise clauses went in. And so there you see the insidious influence of the nuclear weapon states. And so basically, the struggle continues, and it has entered into force and is slowly getting more and more signatories. But ultimately, although it has increased the stigma against nuclear deterrence, we're going to have to go back, or the younger successors are going to have to go back and try to negotiate an enforceable global nuclear weapons convention like the ones that have been established for chemical and biological weapons, but remembering that nuclear weapons are far worse. So this is the only ultimate way to finally open the way to getting rid of nuclear weapons. And of course, the key to that is to acknowledge that nuclear deterrence is an irresponsible confidence trick.
Speaking of nuclear states beyond those named, North Korea, I mean, Kim Jong-un regularly threatens the use of nuclear weapons. And then there's this, I think, valid fear of Iran getting nuclear weapons. What a box the world is in with the spread of nuclear weaponry.
Yes. And again, it's rather like with Putin, that their leaders are basically following the lead of the current of five recognized nuclear weapon states that basically adhere to nuclear deterrence dogma. And so they sense that the only way to defend themselves is they've got to get nuclear weapons too. And so basically this is a recipe for nuclear proliferation. It is not the way to go in terms of trying to improve one's security. And so it has proved with North Korea, and so this is the problem that we have to get round.
And it's indeed some problem. I mean, what your book calls for, what you call for, is a nuclear-free world. And actually, you point out there are areas of the world, because of the United Nations, which are nuclear-free zones, but not the whole world.
No. Of course, the Southern Hemisphere is free of nuclear weapons, except for Diego Garcia, which is the one outpost left from the British Empire, which is being seconded to the Americans to use as a base for punitive expeditions into Eurasia and against China.
Now, you mentioned chemical and biological weapons. An example of the outlawing of chemical warfare is after World War I, the world realized this is after chemical warfare was being used widely during World War I. Soldiers were fighting in gas masks and the deaths from mustard gas and other. In any case, there was a series of treaties and chemical warfare was outlawed. This treaty is beginning in the early 1920s. Why can't the world now come to the same conclusion that that nuclear weapons are horrific and should be outlawed as weapons of war?
Absolutely. And of course, you know, my main motivation for keeping going and for writing this book is that I don't want the world to learn the hard way. And the world learned the hard way in World War I with chemical weapons, and they did take action. But my God, if we have to take action after a nuclear bomb has been used, then we may not be able to take action. And so that is the difference. It is in scale and in threat, it is completely off the wall. And so we have got to start thinking straight and to think about true cooperative common security, where you cannot any longer rely on security at the expense of others' insecurity.
Now, when I was a kid in New York City, they gave us dog tags to wear. We did duck and cover. It was New York City, and you know, it was considered to be a main target of the Soviets. And I wrote a book, actually, co-authored by a historian, this is a year and a half ago, called Cold War Long Island. But actually, when I began the book, I had no idea that I would be reliving so much of that because of Ukraine, basically.
Oh, I know. Yes, and I actually do feel that we're in more dangerous times than the Cold War at the moment. And people really? Just don't realize it. So, you know, there's so many trite comments trotted off about using nuclear weapons. And it seems that the prospect of getting rid of them is more frightening for these leaders than retaining them. But anyway, I continue to be an incurable optimist, because otherwise I wouldn't be doing this.
Thank you so much, Rob Green, for your work through the years.
And thank you, Carl, for giving me this opportunity to spread my subversive views in the cause of human sanity and survival.
This has been Carl Grossman. You've been watching Enviro Close-Up. Thank you for watching.